Wilfred McClay is the GT and Libby Blankenship Chair in the History of Liberty at the University of Oklahoma. He has served as a senior scholar of the Woodrow Wilson International Center for Scholars, a senior fellow at the Ethics and Public Policy Institute, and at the Trinity Forum. He is a member of the Society of Scholars at the James Madison Program at Princeton University, serves on the editorial and advisory boards of the Wilson Quarterly, First Things Society, Historically Speaking, the University Bookman, the Blue Atlantis, and the City, and probably a dozen others I don't know about. Wilfred's many distinguished publications include his book with a wonderful title, The Masterless Self and Society in Modern America, which won the 1995 Merle Curti Award from the Organization of American Historians. His more recent publications include The Student's Guide to U.S. History, and in 2014, a book he edited with Ted McAllister, Why Place Matters, Geography, Identity, and Civic Life in Modern America. He received his bachelor's degree from St. John's College in Annapolis and his doctoral degree in history from Johns Hopkins University. He's taught at Tulane, Pepperdine, Georgetown, University of Dallas, and as a senior Fulbright lecturer at the University of Rome. Now, the National Association of Scholars as a body is devoted to liberal education, which, among other things, means we care a lot about precision in writing, eloquence in speaking, and all-round learning as an exhibit of one's devotion to the civilization in which we're trying to advance and be part of. I can think of few people that match Wilfred McClay's mastery of all these arts, and I am delighted that he is about to speak to us on, I don't actually have the title of what you're speaking on, but I'm going to be joyfully surprised, as Ashley would say.
Thank you, Peter. And that's an introduction I can't possibly live up to, but I'll do my best. Thank you all for coming. This is wonderful to have you here in Oklahoma. I act as if I've been here all my life, and there are Paul Ray and Ted McAllister, people who grew up here are looking at me scoffing under their breath. But it's a very warm and accommodating place, and I've really enjoyed being here for 3.5 years. The program, actually the title, Peter, just for your interest, is Rewriting American History, which actually I didn't know until I saw the program. I thought it was something having to do with the AP U.S. history controversy, which I was involved in, as was Peter, as were several other people who shall be nameless. And this has to do with when the College Board, which runs and administers all the advanced placement examinations, revised the framework for the AP U.S. history exam in 2014. And there was an outcry from a number of historians. And we put together a letter, which I think upwards of 200 people in the end signed, beseeching the College Board to reconsider some of the changes they had made, which I'll talk a little bit about in my remarks. And we never got an acknowledgement. Did we ever, Peter, get an acknowledgement? I don't think they ever acknowledged the letter, but they did acknowledge our concerns and threw in a few, George Washington and James Madison, whose names were missing from the original framework as proper objects of study in advanced placement course. And to my knowledge, they didn't take out anything that was already there. They just added in a few things. And some people were very happy with this. Dan Henninger of the Wall Street Journal said, "Conservatives, you won, stop complaining." But some of us were not nearly so pleased with the end results, because it didn't actually change much of anything about the new standards. I don't want to get too much into all of that, although I'm happy to answer any questions that you have to the best of my ability. But I want to sort of cut to the chase here and offer my thoughts about what did we learn? What have we learned from this encounter with the College Board and the subsequent encounter with the European standards, which this gentleman here has pretty much eviscerated, at least in my view. I think the thing we've learned, to put it gently, from the encounter with the College Board is there needs to be an alternative to it. I don't think, for years and years, the College Board, and I'll talk a little bit about this later in my talk, the College Board has been respected as a sort of neutral, relatively neutral arbiter of a test that actually allowed a lot of flexibility to individual classroom instructors. But the direction is, the movement now is in the opposite direction, and it's very concerning because no one organization should have a monopoly on the certification of the advanced placement in the first place. I mean, it's kind of staggering when you think about it that this has happened and that there are no competitors out there. But it's even more concerning that, in fact, it appears to many of us that consciously or not, and we think probably consciously, the AP U.S. History exam is being used as a way to get through the back door the kind of thing that the National History Standards controversy in the 1990s failed to do, that is to impose a de facto national history curriculum, but as I say, by the back door. The AP test is increasingly important as a kind of gold standard of a signifier of merit, so that a high school student's education is regarded as substantial if he or she has taken lots of AP exams. Actually, it's interesting that the colleges, admissions people are very interested in seeing lots of exams taken, preferably passed, you know, with a 3 or better. But they're not quite as interested as they used to be in giving credit for those exams. In fact, the AP U.S. History, 1 out of 8 of the students who take the exam will actually end up getting college credit for it, which is a kind of an amazing statistic. And it tells you something about where things are going. Colleges, of course, are wising up about this business of giving away credit hours which could be revenue producing by giving kids college credit for high school courses. So it makes perfect sense that they're increasingly unwilling to grant college credit in their institutions. But the stakes are high here, nonetheless, because the AP standards requirements can, over time, become regulative of what's included not only in AP courses, but all courses, high school courses in American history. College Board is making a concerted effort to extend the taking of the test to more and more students. In some school districts in Florida that I'm aware of, every student takes the AP exam. It's all subsidized by ultimately by the Department of Education, ultimately by Bill Gates, actually. that desire to make the taking of the test as close to universal as possible seems to militate against what were the original intentions of advanced placement. Of course, the strongest argument against our objections to the 2014 revision of the standards is that the revision was merely bringing the course into conformity with what the best university-bred scholarship in history was producing. So, if there was less emphasis on the founders, less emphasis on the Constitution, less emphasis on the intellectual and diplomatic history of the nation, on the formation of national identity, and much more emphasis on global issues, on the global economy, on the slave trade, on the cultivation of small and smaller subcultural identities. Well, this change only reflected what scholars were in fact doing. The most prominent scholars in the academy were actually doing. And so shouldn't an AP course, if it's truly a college course for high school students, reflect what's actually being done in a college course? It's not an entirely bad argument. It's a little disingenuous, but it's forensically not a bad effort. But I think it mainly shows that there ought to be a difference made, a distinction drawn between high school and college U.S. history courses. It may be that there's been a faulty premise embedded for a long time in the way that we've thought about advanced placement. And I'd like to spend the rest of my time with you exploring that and the implications of that for how we think about advanced placement, how it relates to civic formation, civic education, et cetera. So I think it will tie into the issues that have already been being discussed this morning. History and historical study are in a bad way these days in the United States, and for more reasons than one. One of them is that we have lost our way by forgetting that the study of the past makes most sense when it's connected to a larger public purpose, a public meaning, and is thereby woven into the warp and woof of our common life. So in that connection, let me say something a little bit bold. The chief purpose of a high school education in American history is not the development of critical thinking and analytic skills, although the acquisition of such skills is a good thing, an important thing. It is not the mastery of facts, although a solid grasp of the factual basis of American history is surely essential to any knowledge of it. Nor is the chief purpose the acquisition of a genuine historical consciousness, although that would be nice too, especially with students whose attention span, looking backwards, runs about 15 minutes. Nor is it to learn to teach young people to think like a historian, which is the holy grail of a lot of these reformers of history education. None of these things is the chief purpose of high school education in American history. That the chief purpose is as a rite of civic membership, an act of inculcation and formation, a way that the young are introduced to the fullness of their political and cultural inheritance as Americans, enabling them to become literate and conversant in its features, to appropriate all that it has to offer them, both the privileges and the burdens, to make its stories their stories, and thereby let them come into possession of the common treasure of its cultural life. In that sense, the study of history is different from any other academic subject. It's not merely a body of knowledge. It also ushers the individual person into membership in a larger common world and situates them in space and time. I often like to think, the greatest, perhaps arguably the greatest of all stories or metaphors of liberal education is Plato's allegory of the cave, which you all know. And there's a sense in which those who've been liberated from the nether world of flickering lights, firelight and images on the wall, and brought into the light, are also being, and they're not only being ushered into the world of reality, of real things, but ushered into the common world. The intelligible world is the common world. So that, I think, is arguably a good way to think about what history education in American history ought to accomplish, too, to draw people out of their caves their digital caves, I think, for many of them, and into a common world. This is especially necessary in a democracy, as the founders, particularly Thomas Jefferson, or most notably, perhaps, Thomas Jefferson, understood that no popular government could flourish without an educated citizenry, that understood the special virtues of republican self-government and the civic and moral duty of citizens to uphold and guard it. Donald Kagan has said, democracy requires a patriotic education. It does so for two reasons. First, because its success depends on the active participation of citizens in their own governance. And second, because without such an education, there would be no way to persuade free individuals of the need to make sacrifices for the common good. We now seem to think we could dispense with such an education, and in fact are likely to disparage it reflexively. I sometimes think that you could say democracy requires an anti-patriotic education, and you'd have the applause of a great deal of the American professoriate. Martha Nussbaum would be right at the head of the line. That's actually what she sees herself as doing. But Kagan begs to differ. The encouragement of patriotism, he says, is no longer a part of our public education system, and the cost of its omission has made itself felt in a way that would have alarmed and dismayed the founders of our country. So what's happened? Well, I think part of the responsibility lies with the field of history itself. About a century or more ago, professional historians imagined that their discipline could be made a science, able to explain the doings of human beings in the same way, in the same dispassionate precision as physicists and other natural scientists. That confidence is long gone. If anything, it's gone too far the other way. Like so many of the disciplines making up the humanities, human history has been experiencing a slow dissolution, a decline that may now be approaching a critical juncture. Students of academic life study this sort of thing quantitatively, citing shrinking enrollments, disappearing required history courses, things that NES has tabulated, the loss of full-time faculty positions, things people like me notice. But it goes much deeper than that. One senses a lack of self-confidence in the field, a fear that the study of the past may no longer be something valuable or important, a suspicion that history lacks the capacity to be a coherent, truth-seeking enterprise. Instead, it's a relativistic funhouse in which all narratives are equally valid, equally invalid, for that matter. Or perhaps history's useless because the road that we've traveled to date offers no insight into the road we are traveling now. It's only a parade of negative examples of oppression, error, and obsolescence, an endless tableau of Confederate flags, which provide proof that the past has nothing to teach us, nothing to admire, no precedents to apply. This loss of faith in the central importance of history and in a past to which we owe much of what we are pervades much of American society today. Gone are the days when widely shared understandings of the past provided a sense of civilizational unity. Instead, as Princeton historian Daniel Rogers says, we live in an age of fracture. It's actually a rather felicitous term because a fracture implies something that was once whole. An age of fracture in which all narratives are contested, all the disciplines no longer take a broad view of the human condition, rarely speak to one another, and have abandoned the search for common ground in favor of focusing on the concerns and perspectives of ever more minute sub-disciplines, ever smaller groups, ever more finely tuned and exclusive categories of experience, particularly grievance. This is not just a feature of academic life, but it's an emerging feature of American life more broadly. Now, as I said, I want to emphasize that this devolution of history has several causes. It's not only ideological, which I think was maybe some of what I heard this morning was emphasizing the ideological, and all of that's true. But it's also, I think, inherent in the professionalization of history. And that's part of the case I want to make, is that the ideological and the professional both have a role to play. It would be ironic, would it not, if the great advances in professional historiography that have taken place in the past century or so, advances that have exploited fresh data, new techniques of analysis, opened us up to a more expansive understanding of inarticulate or otherwise marginalized people's hidden aspects of the past, that all of this would have come at the expense of a general audience for history and its valuable effects on public life. It would be ironic, but unfortunately it appears to be true. And here's a further irony for you. One of the most poignant laments about this was written by a man, a historian named Thomas Bender. Thomas Bender was one of the leading figures in the revision of the AP U.S. history standards or framework in 2014, and has been very involved in trying to make precisely the changes in the field that are reflected in that. But he wrote an article in the New York Times, the newspaper record, up until a few weeks ago, gloomily entitled, How Historians Lost Their Public. He says, the growth of knowledge, and I agree, by the way, with almost everything he says here, the growth of knowledge in ever more numerous and tightly focused subspecialties of history has resulted in the displacement of the old-fashioned survey courses in colleges and universities. It's an interesting observation. The survey course used to be a kind of gem of the curricular offerings in the history department, and it would be taught by great virtuosic historians, the Jacques Barzin types, who had an expansive scale and synthesizing panache, and of course were great lecturers. Bender, of course, doesn't want to give up any of the advances made by the professions in this ever more intensive form of intellectual cultivation, historical cultivation. But he concedes something has gone wrong. Historians have lost the ability to speak to and command the attention of a larger audience, even a well-educated one, seeking more general meanings in the past. They've lost their public. And he goes on to complain that, people like Tom Brokaw write about the greatest generation and find this audience because they strike a chord with the public. A chord, by the way, that professional historians, by and large, would be not caught dead striking and would decry, as they have, ethnocentrism, triumphalism, uncritically celebratory, all of those kind of standard macros that they pushed on the computer. Some of those criticisms, by the way, are absolutely on target in some cases. But these works are at least being read by a public that's hungry for history. The loss of a public for history may be due to the loss of history for the public. It's worth noting that Bender is not, by far from being the first to notice this problem. A similar plea was made in 1981, just when I was getting started in this business, by the Harvard historian Bernard Bailyn, who's no ideologue of either stripe, in his presidential address to the American Historical Association. But here's what Bailyn said, 1981. The greatest challenge that will face historians in the years ahead is not how to deepen and further sophisticate their technical probes of life in the past, an effort that will, of course, continue in any case. You're right about that. But how to put the story together again, now with a complexity and an analytic dimension never envisioned before. How to draw together the information available, quantitative, qualitative, statistic, literary, visual, oral, into readable accounts of major developments. Well, you may have noticed this hasn't happened, that he's really calling for a squaring of the circle that has been insurmountably difficult to attain. And the fact that we have made so little progress in creating the kinds of new narratives that Balin envisioned ought to give us pause and make us wonder if we should rethink our expectations and our premises. Perhaps there's something wrong with the assumption that the problem is one of translating the findings of specialists into winsome language that non-specialists can read. Perhaps the problem goes a great deal deeper than that. Perhaps there's something vitally important, a missing principle of organization that professional historical writing almost by definition cannot provide. It seems, in fact, that, not to oversimplify the matter too much, but that professional historiography is produced mainly for the consumption of professional historians. This is actually a common fault in academic fields across the spectrum. The very proposition that professional historiography should concern itself in fundamental ways with civic needs, although in the terms of the new civics you were discussing this morning, maybe this would actually fly rather readily, but otherwise it's something the profession tends to find suspect. And a great many people would find downright unacceptable, a transgression against the free scholarly inquiry for which they signed up. There can be no doubt, however, that the professionalization of the field has brought a remarkable degree of protection for disciplinary rigor, intellectual freedom in the framing of historical questions. But must abandonment of civic responsibility be part of the professionalization of the field? This is a problem not only for the public, but for the study of history itself, if it can no longer generate an organizing principle from its own resources. Consider in this regard our startling incapacity to create, to design and construct public monuments and memorials. These are the edifices, the classic places where history and public life intersect. They're by their very nature meant to be rallying points for public consciousness, for affirmation of the body politic, past, present, and future, in the act of recollection and commemoration and recommitment to the future. There's a profundity approaching the sacramental in the atmosphere created by such places as they draw together generations of the living, the dead, and those yet unborn in a bond of mutuality and solidarity. Think of, for example, the inauguration of a president and the spectacle, the places, the sort of familiar, almost liturgical aspects of it. The great structures and statuary of the National Mall in Washington, Lincoln Memorial, the Washington Monument, and so on and on, the solemnity of Arlington National Cemetery. These all are examples of what I'm talking about, of public monuments and memorials that perform this focusing and condensing of public consciousness. There's a sense, too, since I mentioned the Confederate flag, there's a sense, too, that cemeteries honoring the soldiers of the Confederacy somehow deserve our general respect, even if the cause for which they fell does not. But these structures, all the ones I'm describing here, were a product of an earlier time when the national consensus was stronger. Today, as is illustrated by the endless deadlock over the erection of a memorial to Dwight D. Eisenhower in Washington, a drama that's become a fiasco, we find the construction of monuments almost impossibly difficult. Consider how long it took for Ground Zero in the 9/11 site to be reconstructed, and frankly, the inadequate job that was done. That's another subject. In a different but not unrelated way, consider the sudden passion to cleanse the American landscape of any and all allusions to the Confederacy or slaveholding, a paroxysm that for me is more reminiscent of Robespierre than Lincoln. This also suggests the emergence of a public that has lost meaningful contact with its own history. Why has this happened? Well, in the case of the Eisenhower Memorial, it's because the job was turned over to a fashionable celebrity architect who proved incapable of subordinating his monumental ego to the task of building a monument to a real American hero. But generally, it's happened because the whole process, the whole proposition of revering and memorializing past events has been called into question by our prevailing ethos, which cares little for the authority of the past and frowns on anything that smacks of hero worship or piety towards forebears. The past is always required to plead its case before the bar of the present, where it always loses. This ethos is especially epitomized in the burgeoning academic study of memory, a term that in this context, memory, refers to something vaguely suspect. Of course, memory, more in a less suspicious way, designates the sense of history, the collective sense of history that we all share, the feature of our consciousness, of our shared consciousness, which is why monuments and other instruments of national commemoration are so important. But the systematic problematizing, that's an academic word par excellence, the problematizing, screwing up, that's what problematizing is, screwing it up. Systematic problematizing of memory, the insistence on subjecting it to endless rounds of interrogation and suspicion under bright, hot lights, aimed at the destabilization of public meanings, this is likely to produce impassable obstacles to effective public commemoration of the past. Historians have always been engaged in debunking of popular misrenderings of the past, going back to Henry Adams and Pocahontas, and a lot of this is quite worthwhile. Paul Ray's colleague Richard Gamble has written a wonderful book taking apart the notion of America as a city on a hill and showing that we really, really ought not to be flinging that around the way we have been. But the field of memory studies, and of course anything that is studies, where the noun is studies, you should be ready to interrogate that field. Memory studies carries this debunking further, relentlessly approaching collective memory as nothing more than a willful construction of reality imposed by those with power. Memory, argues historian John Gillis, has no existence beyond our politics, our social relations, and our histories. We have no alternative, he says, but to construct new memories as well as new identities better suited to the complexities of a post-national era. Yeah, take that, Nigel Farage. No alternative but to construct new memories as well as new identities better suited to the complexities of a post-national era. Astonishing. This is nothing less than a drive, well, in addition to massive indoctrination, brainwashing, but a desire to expel the nation state and completely reconstitute public consciousness around a different notion of the purpose of history, a whole new set of loyalties, narratives, heroes, notable events, replacing the ones now inhering in civic life as it now exists. Complete rupture with the past and all admired things that formerly associated themselves with the idea of the nation. Ernest Renan argued that the nation was, quote, a large-scale solidarity constituted by the feelings of the sacrifices that one's made in the past and of those that one's prepared to make in the future as a desire to continue a common life. Lincoln's Gettysburg Address perfect. Expresses that sense that sacrifices these fallen not only provide something that one should admire in the past, but propel forward activity in the present and the future. All this would be placed in jeopardy by this false understanding of memory. So a better way of thinking about this would be to think of historical consciousness as standing in the same relation to civilized life that memory does to individual identity. Without memory as individuals, without the stories within memories are suspended, we really, in the end, cannot say who we are. We cannot learn, use language, pass on knowledge, raise children, engage in science, or even dwell together in society, nor can we have a sense of the future as a time we know will come as other futures have come. A culture without memory will be barbarous and tyrannized, even if technologically advanced, because the drumbeat of daily events will drown out our efforts to connect past, present, and future. So memory is a crucial source of continuity, but something more needs to be said. And this is, I hope, beginning to get us back to the textbook issue, to AP history. We don't acquire a life-enhancing memory or lively historical consciousness through the mere piling up of facts. It's not as if the more facts you retain, the better off you are. It might make you very good on Jeopardy, but otherwise, that's about the extent of it. Instead, memory is most powerful when it's purposeful, when it's selective, when it provides a grid or pattern of organization within which the facts arrange themselves and take on significance. Above all, it requires that we possess stories and narratives that link facts in ways that are meaningful and truthful, and provide a principle of selection, a way of knowing what facts are worth attending to. That's how and why we remember the most meaningful things and make meaning out of them. Without these patterns, facts are unremembered or arranged haphazardly, and history is, as Henry Ford's reputed to have said, one damn thing after another. I love the story. I'm going to skip over it in the interest of time, but there's a wonderful story in the lore of psychiatry about a Russian journalist who's always called S. I think we do know who he actually was, but he was somebody who had a phenomenal memory, could remember every detail. He was a journalist, and this memory came up when his boss accused him of not paying attention during a meeting, and he went and recited every word that had been spoken in the meeting, and the editor was so impressed, he had him tested by the leading psychologist of the day. Yes, he could remember anything, just an astonishing array of memories, but he couldn't make sense out of any of it. So that, just to give an example, he could, if you presented him with an ordinal sequence of numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, he could remember all the numbers up to 235,000, but he had no sense that they were in an ordinal sequence. He didn't have the ability to find patterns. He couldn't understand poetry because he couldn't understand figurative use of language. He couldn't recognize faces because, after all, you know, Peter Wood smiling looks different than Peter Wood frowning. So they're different people. So this man could not function in the world because he had too powerful a memory. It's a fascinating case. It actually bears some relationship to some kinds of autisms in which the problem is a hypersensitivity to all the sensations and impulses that the individual is bombarded with, an inability to make order out of it. So, as S's example illustrates, the sheer retention of factual knowledge is not the key to effective memory. Something else has to come in play, and what comes into play is a certain balance in the mental economy of remembering and forgetting. Memory takes an active role in thinning out the trees to make the forest discernible. It's selective by nature, and this is for Rob Jackson and our other classicists here. It's reflected in the Greek word logos, which comes from the verb lege, meaning to select. To give a logos, a rational account of something, one has to select the details to be stressed and leave the others out. when a lawyer, a trial lawyer, is relating his account of the commission of a crime, he doesn't also describe the temperature outside, the relative humidity, the singing birds, the clouds in the sky, the sound of lawnmowers and passing traffic, and every other. No, he doesn't do that because those things are not essential to forming a theory of the case, a logos of the crime. Instead, we try to remember those things that fit a template of meaning and point to a larger whole. So that brings me back to the AP test and the controversy over it. And the fact the AP people, the College Board people, have argued, as I mentioned before, that the revision of the AP exam sought to make the exam more perfectly reflect the contents of a typical collegiate introductory survey course in American history. This is a huge problem. Because as Thomas Bender, historians have lost their public fame a few moments ago, as Thomas Bender has observed, the introductory survey course, which was once the glory of the college history department, is now the neglected stepchild, if even it has that much status, since the survey course is generally taught by adjuncts or graduate students, and avoided like the plague by even the most junior tenurable faculty. Of course, has been weakened within the structure of the university precisely by the success of the AP exam in years past. It is, as any of us who've taught the American History Survey know, it tends to be a hodgepodge at best, and a tale of endless oppression at worst, but more often a sort of hodgepodge plus, and not something that conduces to the kind of coherent foundational narrative that I've described as being the basis for memory. a couple of words about AP, although I'm conscious I'm running a little long here. It was introduced in the years immediately after the Second World War, which is a time, as you recall, when colleges and universities did not have enough space for the many, many students streaming in from the war through the GI Bill and other things. And it grants credits or advanced placement based on students' AP test scores. For many students, the AP test AP course and test takes the place of a required U.S. History Survey course in colleges and universities, which is a good thing, since as NAS and ACTA and others have shown, most places don't have those required courses anymore anyway. But that makes this whole question, this whole controversy over the AP exam all the more important from the standpoint of civic education. Since many of these students will never take another course in American history. Pervasive use of the test has many sources, and I've talked about some of them, but so far, up to now, surely one of the reasons is there's a general trust that has been reposed in the test. Those of us who came out against it did not do so lightly. It's over the years, the College Board has retained this trust by being sensible about striking a balance between different approaches to the American past and giving a lot of latitude to the individual classroom instructors and being fairly liberal in the good sense in the restrictions or constraints that they apply to those teachers, because since their ability to teach the course is conditional on the College Board's approval. That's all changing. In the past, they had a 5-page document outlining the test's general framework. Now it's 134 pages, actually 147 after the revisions of the revisions. And this is clearly a radical change, repudiation of the earlier approach, a lurch in the direction of more centralized control, and the expression of a distinct agenda. An agenda that downplays content knowledge in favor of interpretive finesse, not learning to think like a historian, and that seeks to de-emphasize American citizenship and American world leadership in favor of a more global, where have you heard that word before, global and transnational perspective. This new framework is organized around such opaque and abstract concepts as identity, peopling, and human geography. It gives only the most cursory attention to traditional subjects, such as the sources, meaning, and development of the American in political institutions, the Constitution, narrative accounting of political events, such as elections, wars, and diplomacy. They did fix a lot of this in a very cursory way in the way they responded to the critics, but the criticism still holds. These are not integral, they're just thrown in so that it could be said that they are present. various critics noticed the political and ideological biases in this framework. Some of that is murky, I will concede. I think there are two sides to the argument about some of the issues, but where there is not, I think, any doubt is the 2010 framework, the previous framework, treated national identity, including, I quote, views of the American national character and ideas about American exceptionalism, close quote, as a central theme. The 2014 framework does not. Instead, it grants attention to, quote, how various identities, cultures, and values have been preserved or changed in different contexts of U.S. history, with special attention given to the formation of gender, class, racial, and ethnic identities. By the way, in addition to being reeking of ideological intervention, it's colossally boring. The approach, I've talked to a lot of AP teachers since I've been very out front about this, many of whom ask me, please don't disclose my name, because they're afraid that if it becomes public knowledge that they're critical, the College Board will lower the boom on them. But they say one of the biggest problems with this approach is that it's so boring to students. Students are not getting excited. Wow, the gender and migration and intersectionality correlate. Oh, I have never thought of any of this. They're really just watching the clock and waiting for it all to be over. So the new framework clearly represents a shift from national identity to subcultural identities and global identity. The two go together. Paul Ray had a wonderful phrase about not nation building but nation destroying or nation and it goes both ways. Destroy the nation to build something larger, destroy the nation to concentrate on things that are smaller. If this framework is allowed to take hold, even in its somewhat revised version, the new version of the test has the possibility, and nothing is definite, but of further marginalizing traditional ways of teaching about the American past and forcing American high schools to teach U.S. history from a perspective that self-consciously seeks to decenter American national identity. Is this the right way to prepare young people for American citizenship? I think we may all agree about that, but this is a question that seems to me can be fruitfully put to people who might not share our views in other ways, but might say, you know, maybe it really isn't the best way to prepare young people for American citizenship. How, after all, can we call forth acts of sacrifice that our democracy needs, not only on the battlefield, but also in our daily lives, and paying those Obamacare premiums, for example, dedication to the common good, that requires such acts at the heart of civilized life. How can we do this without training up citizens who know about and appreciate the democracy and they care about the common good, feel themselves to be part of the nation's community of memory? How can we expect our citizens to grapple with enduring national debates, the role of the Constitution, separation of powers, and so on, if they know nothing of the long trail of these particular debates and are instead taught to translate them into the one-size-fits-all language of global and transnational things. As I said, some of the revision of the standards has improved in many of these areas, but on the question of global citizenship and the centrality of it, it has not given any ground. We speak of global citizenship reflexively these days, see it as a form of advanced consciousness to which our students should, of course, be made to aspire, along with non-judgmentalism and the whole strain of politically correct attitudes. But of course, global citizenship is at best a fanciful phrase, abstract, remote, unspecific in its requirements. In fact, there are no requirements. Actual citizenship is different. It entails membership in the life of a particular place. It means having a home address, literally and figuratively. Education does young people no favors when it fails to equip them for that kind of membership, nor does it do the rest of us any favors. We won't be able to uphold our democracy unless we know our great stories, our admirable deeds of our great men and women. The new APUS history framework fails on that count because it does not see the civic role of education as a central one. It instead offers us, and this is one of my favorite jokes, it's at the expense of Unitarians, so I hope there are no Unitarians here, and you'll forgive me. That is part of your religious tradition, if you are Unitarian, to forgive me. So forgive me in advance for this joke, but have any of you ever heard the joke about what you get when you cross a Unitarian with a Ku Klux Klansman? It's a person who goes around planting burning question marks on other people's lawns. And that, I think, is the ideal to which a great many of the people who teach or propose to instruct others in the teaching of American history aspire. The ideal of planting burning question marks in young people's minds. I hope I've given you reason to think that's not a particularly good way to go about things. Thank you very much. Can I stay up here?
We have about 20 minutes for
questions. Okay, 20 minutes.
And people should come up front again.
Will, thank you very much.
Thank you, Jim.
I wonder if you could talk a little bit about the challenges of memory in terms of developing memory for people who are very young, who are just children, and how the beginnings of sort of dispensing with all the things that you had to memorize when you were in school. Because if you need to know them, you can get them this way quickly, and then you can forget them as soon as they're no longer useful. Sort of demoralizes teachers who would have imposed that sort of thing on students, and ends up leading to students of ours who come to college knowing nothing at all. And so I wonder how developing that kind of memory can be encouraged, given those.
Yeah. Well, you know, you're really talking about memory in a very fundamental, elemental, nitty-gritty way. That if you outsource your memory to a little device. I used to know what my name was. Oh yeah, here. and that's true for all kinds of things. I've said actually, NES did it. Academic Questions did a feature a number of years ago about if you could just change one thing in education, what would you do? And I said, and I've actually tried to incorporate this into my teaching with varied success, but that I would require students to memorize, as a condition of their graduation, a certain number of key sort of classic canonical texts in American history. The Gettysburg Address might be one of them. Preamble to the Constitution, or the first few paragraphs of the Declaration of Independence. You know, make your own list. I would include Robert Frost's poem, The Gift Outright, which I think is one of the great pieces of writing about America. But, you know, and memorizing is such a, it is so antique that it's radical now. What it does is it introduces students to the idea, which they may not appreciate until later in life, but that's always been true of education, everything about education, that when you memorize something, you really appropriate it. You really make it your own in a way that having it on your Kindle, which isn't even your own book, but having it on your device, having it somewhere else, having it in your library even, it's not the same as making it your own. So memorizing poems, memorizing great works of political oratory, which used to be part of education. I think that's actually something you could bring back fairly easily. And my kids, when I've had them do this, they treat it as a game, and it's sort of fun. I run into them in the halls, and they'll say, they'll quote some line out of one of Lincoln's speeches or whatever. And I think that's actually rather painless. Now, of course, that doesn't deal with the entirety, the vastness of the problem you're talking about. But forgive me, I'll give you a very idiosyncratic portion of the answer, too. I as you know, went to St. John's College in Annapolis, Maryland, which it's known as a great book school, but part of what is really unique about it is that everybody reads the same things. So that any student at St. John's, when you're a senior, you can know that every other senior has read all the same books that you've read. And so you can make references to, a priori synthetic knowledge, and they know you're talking about Kant's Critique of Pure Reason or whatever. To have that commonality, that intertextual commonality, to use a pretentious way of putting it, is an incomparable experience. It's what people used to have through culture-wide knowledge of the Bible. So when Lincoln would say, house divided against itself cannot stand, which actually is not particularly appropriate to the context in the Bible, but leave that aside. It's a phrase everyone knew, because for one thing, they didn't have 47 different translations, the Living Bible, the Dead Bible, the Intermediate Bible. Yeah. But it was all King James, and it was part of their education. It was central to their education. Even the relatively less than fully literate people would know those phrases. So, and those are the building blocks of culture. So I may have answered your question by just repeating it back to you in a way, but I think we have to find ways of making our cultural commonalities features that are not just in our iPads, but are in our hearts and minds. And that's something that the sort of techno-fetishism of our educational establishment, particularly in primary and secondary schools, is light years away from understanding, I'm afraid. Yes, sir.
You're a historian, and I'm not.
Don't lord it over me. Okay?
No, I'm not. But. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think it was Stalin who said that he who controls history controls the future.
It sounds very Stalinist. Yeah.
Yes, it does. As a physician, I want to make an analogy to the medical side of memory as history. In Alzheimer's disease, the first thing that goes is memory. After that goes judgment. And after that comes increasing and ultimately total dependence on another. And I sometimes see dark motives where none exist, but I wonder if this is not part of that same analogous theme, and I'd be interested in your comment.
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, look, Orwell's work is full of this sort of the idea that you expressed with that quotation, that once you can control what is remembered, you can accomplish almost anything. I did want to, since you mentioned Alzheimer's, I passed a little lightly over the story of S, but if you're interested, this is a book, the best account of it I've ever seen is a book called The Forgetting, which is by a guy named Schenck. I can't remember his first name, but it's a book about Alzheimer's disease. I've had graduate students in history read it because it seems to me to have so much to say about historical knowledge and the cultural analogs to that. Yes, and you know, one of the other things about a memory that I think relates to the memory research, and I don't follow this very closely, it's not my field, but we do have somebody at OU who's very deeply involved in this cutting edge stuff. And he said, look, more and more we are coming to the conclusion that every act of remembering is an act of re-remembering. So every time you remember, even the most commonplace details, your wife's name, you know, your address, whatever, you're sort of freshly remembering it. It's not like St. Augustine's notion that there's this sort of treasury and you go in and pull things out and then put them back, or any of the other ways that memory's been analogized, but that it is, there's a constant remaking of memories, which is why a certain kind of revisionism in history is actually a healthy thing, because we're constantly rethinking the past, constantly reappropriating it. And when that goes, when that faculty goes, as you say, it's what holds everything together in the soul.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. I've got two sort of independent points. The first is, I wonder...
I've got my pen. This is my memory. I can't...
I wonder if this decrease in historical memory and historical consciousness has some role to play with the rise of so-called, to use a word I hate, extremist ideologies. So, for instance, it might seem puzzling why somebody would leave a prosperous Western country to join the Islamic State, as thousands have. And they're not poor, and they're not oppressed, and that's been completely debunked. And it seems like that can be pretty well explained, or at least partially explained, by thinking, like, well, what are they getting for this? Well, they're getting an identity, and they're getting a connection with history that involves, you know, a connection with the prophet that continues into the history, hopefully very distant, in which there's a global caliphate. And it seems like that goes some way to explain the psychology. I think likewise with the so-called alt-right movement, why is it that this white nationalism would now be picking up steam after it's been so out of fashion for so long? And it seems like maybe one of the explanations would be that, well, what the mainstream culture is giving the white men doesn't appeal to any sort of sense of identity. Their inheritance is only guilt. And here's someone saying, oh, no, you're connected to a great history and that goes forward and involves your dominance, and isn't that great? So that is the first point, is to ask.
Oh. Can I comment on that? Because that's very rich. I mean, I agree with you. Just let me take the white nationalist part first. I mean, I think a lot of us have been predicting something like this was going to happen eventually, because if you make identity politics not only fair game, but a sort of irrevocable right to build your life as you please, according to those wonderful sweet mystery of life words from the Supreme Court, around your identity, whatever you choose to call it, however you identify, the time was going to come when some white people would say, okay, we're going to play this game too. We're going to be victims too. We're going to be outsiders too. We're going to be marginalized people. We can play this game. And the only answer to that is, no, you're the only ones who don't get to play that game. But we've decided. And that's not a very strong argument, I'm afraid, especially against angry people. So it does, I think, relate to this sort of the deconstruction of America that's been going on since the 60s, and maybe even a little before. And as for the, I'm as fascinated as you are about these converts to radical jihadist Islam. This may be superficial of me, but I tend to analogize it to things I saw when I was younger in the 70s, but also started in the 60s. People who would sort of come out of suburban America and become Hare Krishnas or involve themselves with some kind of outlandish cult that involved separating themselves from everything they had grown up with and known. They, to put it in a somewhat banal way, they lacked a usable past. And so the choice is to obliterate it, to renounce it, and embrace a sort of ersatz past, ready-made, off the shelf, with prophets and holy, particular readings of holy scriptures, and all sort of blanks filled in as to purpose in life. I try not to pathologize all of people's religious decisions, but that does seem to me clear to have elements of pathology that may relate to an absence of a sense of groundedness in the past. So I agree. Let's go for two here.
All right, so my second point is intellectuals tend to seem to think a sense of attachment, a place of a particular identity, at least with regard to national identity, is some sort of limitation on this reservoir of universal benevolence, as if we ever had this to begin with. But I wanted to point out the contrast with how they view their own institutions. If you go and do a tour of a college campus, they're not going, as you say, it's not going to be just some reciting a bunch of bland facts. You're going to see, almost icons, like here are all the presidents we've had, here is when we won that championship in 1980, this is the story behind this building, here are some famous people, there are going to be statues. All of that, you might ask, if that's important for a particular institution to have this, not just a knowledge of propositional facts, but a sense of attachment and belonging and so on and so forth, why would it not be also true of the society in which that institution is a part?
Yeah. All I would say about this, I think there's a legitimate and important conversation to be had, maybe even a debate to be had about whether membership in a nation, how membership, the category membership, may be different in different levels and scales of organization. That to be, a lot of us, I'm a big admirer of Robert Nisbet, the sociologist, and Nisbet had an allergy to the concept of national community, that nations cannot be communities.
I think I said society.
Yeah, no, I'm really trying to make a broader point. I'm not at all pushing against you on this. I'm making a broader point that my affection for the University of Oklahoma or St. John's or other institutions I've been associated with, and the lore, in the sense, this is the statue where such and such proposed to such and such, and all of those elements of personal memory that kind of flow into a shared memory is part of the wonder of our lives together in those kinds of places. But it may be different than the sense of membership in a family. A lot of progressives like to talk about the nation as a family. Or Mario Cuomo, was that we're all on a wagon train together. It just crazy stuff. It's important to have a sense of what commonalities, what centripetal forces are appropriate to strive for. And the people like Benedict Anderson and others who are critics of nationalism, and actually, who isn't that writes about nationalism? Everybody's critical. Their criticism, Hobsbawm and his collaborator wrote the book, The Invention of Tradition, is with the idea that nations invent traditions. They invent songs. They invent ersatz traditions. You know, the Scots invent their tartans. That's one of the great arguments in Hobsbawm's book. And so, therefore, you know, you should be deeply suspicious of nation states, because nation states are preeminently involved in this hocus pocus, I'm presenting their argument, of creating seeming communities, imagined communities, in which people can be mobilized for war, or imperial exploits, or other bad things that nation states do, since nation states only do bad things, by and large. I don't hold with that, any of that, but I think there is, or much of it, but I think there is a legitimate debate to be had about when, for example, Woodrow Wilson pumped up anti-German sentiment in the First World War in order to sort of mobilize the American public to engage in a war they really didn't want to be part of. I'm oversimplifying a little bit, but that's basically right. The use of propaganda, the Creel Committee, all that. This is something in our own history that we should know about, that should give us pause in thinking about how, what's appropriate. Was this sort of excessively negative presentation of Germans really a good thing, a necessary thing? Was it necessary to form the kind of community, the kind of sense of fellow feeling and mutuality that we want? So I think there's legitimate debates to be had about that kind of thing, and about whether, you know, one way of looking at American federalism is that it's a system in which the national level of meaning, like the national government, is limited. That we have, ideally, our affiliation should be just as strong to our states and localities as to our nations. Whereas you look at, say, Eugene Weber's account of peasants' entrenchment, you know, there's a whole view of European nationalism that it requires the obliteration of particular associations to make the nation state. This is not the American tradition. This is not the way we have thought about it. It's not what our Constitution is designed to bring about.
One more
yes, sir.
Thank you very much. And I was wondering if you could comment on the recent demands to rename buildings and things like that on college campuses, and whether that's always a bad idea, or sometimes a bad idea, or never a bad idea. What's your criteria?
I think I'm in the middle. Sometimes, I mean, I think for one thing that it's not for me to say what Yale wants to do about John C. Calhoun. I certainly have an opinion about it. I think it's good for them to have a building named after John C. Calhoun, and to have to trip over that fact and deal with it and know that that is part of their heritage. They can't just sort of take the money and run, so to speak, and wipe out the memory, the memory of particular benefactors, of the Cecil Rhodeses and people who are being now systematically gone after in the UK and here because of their associations with things that we now see as very bad. I think remember I said in my talk that this is more like Robespierre than like Lincoln. I mean, it is that kind of wiping out the past that I think is dishonest, and it's not really fruitful. I remember in, you know, the opera house in Rome. It's not one of the great opera houses in Italy, but I remember going there with my wife and sitting back in my seat, looking up, oh, way above the stage, there's a little medal, to anybody know, to Mussolini. And it's still there. There's no Via Mussolini that I know of in Rome, but There are via, you know, what's his name? The guy, the Marxist hero who was in prison. I can't think of his name.
Gramsci.
Yeah, Gramsci. There's an Antonio Gramsci Avenue everywhere, about via Antonio. But I don't know of any Mussolini, but they've never taken that down. And there may be a lot of reasons for that, but I think there's some way in which a kind of Roman attitude that sometimes you've got to take the bitter with the sweet with history, and you're not constantly in the business of going through the family album and saying, well, Uncle Ernie, I didn't like him very much. Let's just crop him out. I think the energy that's wasted, particularly over adjudicating issues that have to do with slavery, with people long dead and whose heirs and descendants are nowhere to be found, it seems to me a kind of sinister distraction from the real problems that we face, the real problems of the society, real problems of higher education. So I'm mostly against it, but I also think, you know, Yale's a private university, not to pick on Yale, but they've been in the news a lot on these kinds of things. And I guess I should speak in there. They ultimately can do what they want, and it is their community. I would just say that they have the benefit of having a very rich community life that goes back to the earliest pre-national times of American history. I mean, they carry a lot of weight. They're not carrying it very well right now, but they still carry it. And I think they need to take that into account and have that sense of historical stewardship in making these decisions. I don't think much of that's going on. Paul, you're more acquainted with this kind of thing at Yale, but at any rate, I think a lot of it is a big waste of time. I could have just said that at the beginning and saved all the verbiage. Thank you all.